To talk to the chief, have a meeting, call all the sectors which have funds for assistive technologies, bring them together, tell them that in your budget, how much share can you allocate for new solutions. So existing policy, existing administration, but by tweaking the system, we can bring in the solution that can reach people who are physically challenged. They have good brain, they have good mind, but they are, for some people because of the war, not handicapped because they suffered during this struggle, and some people because of some other reason are not able to use these assets. So these solutions can go a long way. NIF licensed this to a company, and the royalty, the license money came to this girl, 2 lakh rupees, so she's a youngest entrepreneur of our country. She gets royalty on the sale. Two companies they have licensed to, one is Avira and second is Avico. And then, and on non-exclusive license, that means they can license it to 1,000 companies if they wish to. And not just in India, they can license it to any company abroad also. So it is possible that these solutions can be in your country. Not a problem, because people need in your country too. And how much is the cost? 1,500 rupees, which is just about, $20, $30. $20. In $20, this worker is ready. So it's affordable, it is accessible, but it is not available. Why it is not available? Because there is no supply chain for it. Who will build the supply chain? Initially, public systems will have to do that. Then private sector can take over. Initially, public sector. What can public sector do? We will discuss in detail a little later, but just to mention one other thing, you have exhibitions, commercial exhibition, where a lot of manufacturers bring their products to display. Put it up there. Maybe some of the exhibitors in that exhibition might like this idea. And say, can we sign an agreement? I will manufacture it. Correct? And then the linkage has been built. So all the exhibitions that public sector sponsors or supports, commercial exhibitions, marketing exhibition, new product exhibition, all of them should have a corner for adoption. And their job is done, because we don't know which entrepreneur will like which idea. How do we know? So we can just provide them a platform, and then people will start coming forward and signing agreements. And then this can be done by us also. These girls realize that many times young people don't, particularly men, boys, don't wear helmet. So what do you do? So they said, three girls from Tamil Nadu, Bano, Arti, Minotha, and Lala Bano, that if you don't wear helmet, the motorcycle will not start. No, idea was good. They didn't know how to make it. And I contacted a fabricator in Odisha who made this helmet where if you don't wear it or don't put the glove here, the motorcycle will not start. It was showcased at the Rashtrapati Bhavan, President of India's house. Children liked it very much. So I did a small survey of children who were coming to see the exhibition. I asked them which idea was very impressive. They all liked this idea. Because this is interesting. It overcomes a problem that parents are worried about but can't do anything. You know, parents feel worried that their children are going, retiring fast, don't wear a helmet, and you know, all of that. So they, every day they pray that the child should come back safe in the evening. But, and children are adventurous, they don't follow the rules. Now, if that is a policy, but what the public policy? Public policy is, if you insist that manufacturers of helmets will incorporate the Bluetooth technology, which will make it obligatory for connection between the ignition of the vehicle, two-wheeler, and the helmet-wearing system, you have solved the problem. That manufacturers cannot do, that innovator cannot do. That's where the role of public policy is, that you have to create those connections in regulatory policies, in rules, in laws, in guidelines of the traffic management. So police will have to be brought in, the manufacturers will have to be brought in, the Bureau of Standards of your country will have to be brought in, the financing institutions will have to be brought in, banks will have to be told that you will not finance the manufacturer of ordinary helmet, might finance only the helmet which has this provision. So financial institutions will have to be brought in. And then the transport department will issue the guideline, it will issue the orders, and all these institutions will, from their side, reinforce, and the policy will get implemented. So please understand that public policy is a complex process, but it need not be so complex. If we know clearly what are the concomitants of a decision to be implemented, then all those factors have to be woven into the policy. Only then this implementation will take place. common in all the examples that we saw. The common factor was that these innovators didn't have a problem with themselves. They saw somebody else's problem and felt the pain of that third party. Could be grandparents, could be their brothers, sisters, could be anybody on the street. And that is called in our language samvedana. Sam means equal, vedana means pain. When you feel somebody's pain as intensely as that person feels it, it doesn't remain that person's pain, it becomes your pain. When you suffer because somebody else is suffering, internalization of the pain of others can trigger creativity, can trigger innovation. That is, for want of a better word, empathetic innovations. Innovations born out of empathy. Innovations born out of internalization of the pain of others. And it is this internalization which is very important. Now, when you say we don't walk, you know why? That is the closest I can go to the committees and internalize the pain that they have. If I walk for 25 kilometers, I also feel tired. In hot summer, 48 degrees, we were in Orissa. People were saying, you're crazy. We even don't walk at that time. Why are you walking? But that message was there, cutting across. That, okay, you are suffering voluntarily. We suffer involuntarily. But we are realizing what we go through. So we have walked in all the parts of the country, every state. Summer, winter. Summer we go to the places which are hot. Winter we go to the places which are cold. To experience the pain that they have. And then maybe our mind will work better. We will start seeing things that we see but don't observe. We pass by, our mind doesn't register. But then it just starts registering. So it's very important to look at empathy as a driver of such motivations. This is not, you cannot give an order to become empathetic. It has to be generated from within. But if the senior people, once in a while we take time off, and if you go to and walk with your team to one of the slums in Delhi, let us say, for whole Sunday, Saturday, 2 days, you just walk. Whole day in that slum. And say, look, we will take our lunch only when we find at least one person who has solved a problem to their own genius. You know, when the hunger comes, you feel back the hunger, your mind will start searching. Okay, let us find out. Sometimes we have to create pressure on ourselves. We have to raise the expectation on ourselves. How is it possible? So many people are suffering. Somebody must have thought about solving this problem at least. Let us find out that person. But this is a hard way, but this works. This works. And it is very important that we try to incorporate some of the hard ways of such innovations at all levels. So how do we map creativity of our respective countries? One of the key steps that we recognized very early in Honeybee Network was mapping the hot spots of creativity. So way back in 1995-97, we made a map of all the innovations that we have discovered in a project. I can share those maps with you. For Gujarat, we did it. And we found that there were pockets. For livestock, there were different pockets. For pest control, there were different pockets. For varieties, there were different pockets. For farm machinery, there were different pockets. Because the constraints are not uniformly distributed. If constraints are not uniformly distributed, how can creativity be uniformly distributed? You see the mind? The constraints are not uniformly distributed, therefore creativity is also not uniformly distributed. Therefore, if you go to the regions where constraints are intense, we can hope that at least there will be some creative people, some oddballs, who will try to solve this problem. I will give you a simple example. In a village, you have, let us say, 5,000 households, farming household, livestock household. How many mechanics you will have? Maybe two or three. That's it. So to meet 5,000 households or 10,000 households, you can go to a few villages. But to meet 5,000 mechanics, you have to go to so many villages. Rajiv, you understand the point? So please understand, if you want to search for mechanical innovations, then you have to go to far more places. But for agricultural innovations, you can find them differently. Livestock, where the livestock means of primary production, and where it is secondary means of livelihood. In our country, in deserts, livestock is a primary means of production. In Mali, isn't it? In northern part. And in some places, livestock is the secondary means of livestock, central Gujarat, central part of India, North India. In North India, there are few people who will have only livestock. They will have agriculture and livestock. So those who are dependent on livestock completely will develop solutions of a different kind than those for whom livestock is a secondary occupation. Some people are in extensive management, some are in intensive management. Some are trying to survive their animals, some are trying to increase their productivity. Survival innovations are different from intensification innovations. Innovation which just keeps your animal alive so that you can get something by selling them or by their products. As against those who say, no, my animal will keep alive, but I want to get more milk, more meat or more eggs. And those innovations are different. And this is fair because goals, different communities have different goals in their life. So how do we look at if sheep and goat have 20% mortality, cattle has 5% mortality, then obviously in sheep and goat managing communities, the first goal is how to keep my flock alive, isn't it? How to reduce mortality. Whereas in cattle, my goal is how to increase productivity. So please appreciate that the innovations emerge in response to certain challenges that people face. And these challenges are not same everywhere. Therefore, creativity is not uniformly distributed, even if potential is. We are all capable of solving problems, but we are not doing that. All of us are not able to do it. Some people are able to do that. So we will have to recognize, and we should not be disappointed if we do not find innovations of same kind everywhere. So mind should not be tied, mind should not become stereotyped. I will start looking for only this kind of idea. And if I don't find them, then I say, right, no, I'm not interested. Maybe these people are just dull. No. Traditional knowledge is no less important. I'll come to those definitions in a minute. Traditional knowledge of one place can become innovation for another place. You see? A lot of ideas which were commonplace in one community became innovation in another community. So it's very important that we recognize how do we link knowledge system that communities have with the problem-solving system that community ought to have, if they don't have. We should also remember that a lot of us professionals, well-trained, well-paid, live with problems unsolved in our own life. We have a lot of inertia. People also have inertia. They also live with problems unsolved. But in Bangladesh, when they realize that the wood of the boat gets corroded by the salt in the seawater, what do they do? They have to elongate the life for a small fisherman. That boat, if it gets corroded, so much expenditure. So what does he do? He looks for